Throughout the bloody history of Spanish conquest, one man stood out with voice of reason and compassion. Today known as the protector of the Indians, Bartolomé de las Casas took a stand. Bartolomé de las Casas, a short account of the protest against Spanish conquest. Bartolomé de las Casas is recognized as the first defender of Native Americans. With his crude and imagery-filled letters, he would spur change in the New World. His letters, read all over Europe, would leave a lasting image of the atrocities committed against the natives of Latin America. In 1492, at the arrival of Christopher Columbus in America, Spain ensued a reign of terror over the inhabitants of Hispaniola. With their great technological advancements, deadly diseases, and merciless conquistadors, Spain had conquered most of the West Indies by 1508. The Europeans exploited the natives and their land, commencing an encomienda system. With this system, the encomenderos, usually being conquistadors or leaders in raids, would receive grants from the natives, this being in gold or labor. In return, they would Christianize and protect their subjects. The encomienda system instead served as means to enslave the native population and take their lands. On the other side of the globe, Bartolomé was born to a merchant family in Sevilla, Spain. After his father sailed with Columbus to the New World, he gained riches and a large encomienda. With their newfound wealth, Bartolomé was able to study canon law in the University of Salamanca, one of the most prestigious colleges in Spain at the time. At the age of 18, Bartolomé embarked on his first journey to Hispaniola to take control of his family's encomienda and expand his riches through the New World. By then, most of the natives of the large island had been subdued and enslaved. Upon arrival at the island, Nicolás Tovando began a military expedition against the natives. Las Casas joined and gained slaves and riches from the pillage. He would later describe these raids in great detail, describing how the Spaniards forced their way into native settlements, slaughtering everyone they found there, including small children, old men, pregnant women, and even women who had just given birth. They hacked them to pieces, slicing open their bellies with their swords, as though they were so many sheep herded into a pen. They even laid wagers on whether they could manage to slice a man in two at the stroke, or cut an individual's head from his body, or disembowel him with a single blow of their axes. Still, Las Casas participated in the conquest of Cuba, where he won riches and several dozen more slaves. For years, Bartolomé debated the morality of the actions of the Spaniards in the New World. At the time, there were two schools of thought for the natives of America. Some thought they were living testimony of the golden age of mankind when they lived with no sin. The second, and most popular, labeled them lazy savages who had to be governed by the superior Europeans and be brought forth from their savage ways. He ultimately had a change of heart after hearing a sermon from a Dominican friar denouncing the treatment of the natives. Bartolomé was convinced that European exploitation and murder of the natives was not only immoral, but a mortal sin. Las Casas immediately released his Indian slaves and renounced his encomienda. Here commenced a long list of trips he would take to Spain to speak to the king, in retribution of the treatment of the natives. In 1511, Bartolomé traveled to Spain to convince King Ferdinand against the cruel encomienda system. As well-educated and wealthy priest, Las Casas had much freedom of speech and power in Spain, and managed a meeting with the king. Upon arrival, he found that King Ferdinand had recently died. Instead, he spoke with the regent of Spain, Francisco Cisneros. Cisneros, a Spanish cardinal, was perturbed by the images conjured up by Las Casas and sent three hermit monks to take control of the islands. At this time, Bartolomé was pronounced protector of the Indians. Las Casas returned optimistic to the New World, hoping for the complete eradication of the encomienda system and freedom of the natives, but was greatly disappointed. The hermit monks, thrown between political and economic interest, were faced with much resistance and did nothing more than remove some encomiendas from men who were not physically present on their land. Again, Las Casas returned to Spain, this time with less forceful plans. He proposed the new king, Charles I, later to become the Holy Roman Emperor, a peaceful coexistence with the natives. After the natives would be freed from slavery, they would establish a self-governing community and pay tribute to the Spanish crown. Spanish peasants would then travel to the New World and teach the natives farming techniques. Las Casas proposed a small town in Venezuela called Cumana for his ideological project for peaceful coexistence.
Bartolomé de las Casas believed that if he could have a space to settle with the Indians without the interference of the military, where he can just preach and teach, the word of God, he could just then convert them to Christianism. But that didn't happen because that region there was extremely difficult. And the Indians, he actually was coming and going between Spain, Hispaniola, and Cumaná. And at some point he left to Hispaniola, and when he came back, everybody had been killed. The pacified Indians, some of the priests.
The natives, who were tired of slave raids, attacked all Spaniards in Cumaná. Later, Bartolomé would defend their actions by saying that they knew not one Spaniard from another, and thus attacked the peaceful friars. After the painful collapse of Cumaná, Bartolomé joined the Dominican order. Some scholars call his entrance into the Dominican order as his second conversion. While in Puerto Rico, he fervently denounced encomenderos and their treatment of the natives, even going so far as denying encomenderos deathbed viaticum until they had released their slaves. He spoke out against mass baptisms, claiming that conversion had to be done willingly. During this time, he began gathering information for his General History of the Indies and Apologetica Historia. The same year, Las Casas traveled to Mexico City to initiate a peaceful conversion of one of the most hostile native groups. This region was even known as the Land of War. His efforts to convert the Indians with that force proved successful, and he even renamed the town Vera Paz, or True Peace. For a successful experiment, he was pronounced Bishop of Chiapas. Sadly, his efforts were destroyed by the Spaniards, who soon colonized and enslaved the population. After his second coexistence experiment, Bartolomé published his second book called Historia Apologética, in which he refuted prevalent notion that Indians were savages. In 1542, after publishing his most famous work, A Short Account of the Destruction of the Indies, and his incessant letters to the Emperor, Charles V passed the new laws of the Indies. These laws, created to restrict and prevent the exploitation of the indigenous people, limited the power and dominion of the encomenderos. These new laws caused revolts and debates and were only semi-successful. After dedicating most of his life towards emancipating and protecting the natives of America, Bartolomé had garnered many enemies. From stolen gold, silver mines, and exploitation of the indigenous people, Spain had become a wealthy and powerful country. Spain, though, had many powerful enemies, including Britain, France, and the Netherlands, who conjured the Black Legend. This black legend was a propaganda and writing style that demonized Spain. At this time, Europe was experiencing religious and scientific revolutions. The Reformation brought upon costly wars, and Spain's denial of Copernicus' heliocentric model branded Spain as bigoted. Las Casas' pamphlet, Destruction of the Indies, in which he describes in great detail the murder and enslavement of the natives, only helped the black legend. In his search to eradicate the encomienda system, he contracted a new enemy, Juan de Sepúlveda. From this battle came the famous Valladolid debate. The Valladolid debate was the first moral debate in European history about the rights and treatment of a colonized people. In this debate, Bartolomé argues that the natives of America were docile and good people who deserved freedom. Other contenders, most notably Juan de Sepúlveda, argues that Amerindians were savages, citing their human sacrifices and calling them cannibals to defend the wars and murder of the people of America.
Juan Jiménez de Sepúlveda was the very first one to talk and to talk to this group of experts. And he just talked one afternoon. And then Las Casas started. Las Casas did not end. He went on for days and days.
Although no clear winner was pronounced, Bartolomé is known for having had one of the most famous universal human rights debates of the Middle Ages. His fiery debate did not end the encomienda system, but did promote the passing of the second new laws, which further protected the Indians. Bartolomé spent the rest of his life in Spain, when he never stopped writing letters to promote the liberty of the Amerindians. Today, he is critiqued by some scholars for exaggerating the torture and magnitude of the deaths of the New World. Some call him an enemy of Spain for helping spread the Black Legend. Nevertheless, his incessant letters, pamphlets, and books prompted Emperor Charles V to create laws to protect the Indians. His society at Verapaz became proof that peaceful coexistence was possible. His fervent and eloquent battle against abuse inspired revolutions centuries after. Bartolomé fought for a people he was not a part of. He saw injustice in the world and fought for its demise. He was the first to debate universal human rights. From his change of heart in 1514 to the day of his death in 1566, never ceasing to fight against injustice, Bartolomé de las Casas took a stand.